The more we do these podcasts, the more I think I realize how different we are.
What number's this?
This is number 6.
Number 6. I need to apologize in advance if I sound a bit off my game.
Mm-hmm.
I know normally I'm, you know, incredibly sharp and witty.
You are.
I might be a bit off because I haven't been having a lot of sleep lately.
Mm-hmm.
I have had issues.
What issues have you had?
I will tell you about my issues as briefly as I can.
Uh-huh.
I am, as you know, currently in Berkeley, California.
Yes.
And I've been staying sort of in a condo that I've like rented a room in.
Mm-hmm.
And I arrived the other night and it turns out there were some issues. Because what's going on is the guy who's like renting out this room, when he hasn't got paying customers like me, he allows these couch surfers that stay for free. You know, this couch surfing thing.
Yes, I know couch surfing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a good thing. Anyway, he allows couch surfers to stay for free. Which, you know, isn't the nicest thing to know about when you're paying for the place. But anyway, what he does with his apartment when I'm not there is not my business.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem was, when I arrived, this couch surfer person was still there. And he didn't know the couch surfer was still going to be there. And this particular woman, who I would describe as eccentric,
uh-huh.
owns 3 cats.
Ah.
And she had the cats staying in the place.
Ah.
Now, I'm not anti-cat, but this woman was out a lot and her cats were not particularly controllable. She certainly had no control over them. And there were 3 of them in this tiny place. And there's, you know, so there's a cat litter tray in the kitchen and food everywhere and hair everywhere and cats everywhere. So, you know, I was telling the landlord this probably wasn't ideal. And,
uh-huh.
and he was mortified. She was basically squatting. Uh-huh. By this point. So he sent people around, his friends, to try and get rid of her and she wouldn't go. And then she bunkered herself in the other room with her cats. And it was all very awkward.
I'd imagine so.
Anyway, to cut a long story to a medium length, she left eventually, thank goodness, took her cats. But the problem was, obviously before she left, during this period where she was bunkered in the room, hiding from everything, the cats peed. The room where she was staying now smells unbearably bad. Really bad. Like, so I've shut it and locked it up and put like blankets at the bottom of the door to sort of seal it perfectly. But the smell is starting to escape. And in the middle of last night, about 2 in the morning, the smell finally thoroughly permeated the room I'm sleeping in. And so bad that it woke me up and I couldn't get back to sleep. So I have been kept awake all night by the smell of cat pee. And I come to this podcast now a product of that lack of sleep and ordeal.
I gotta ask.
Mm.
Are you gonna stay there? Well, I mean, you're in San Francisco for like a month, aren't you?
Yeah, the landlord's really nice.
I don't care how nice the landlord is. That could not be more irrelevant, my friend. The landlord's really nice.
And the place is nice.
Yeah, keep telling me about how nice it is. I want to hear more. Tell me you like the interior decorating. Is it to your taste? Right? It's perfectly great except for the cat pee everywhere. What's wrong with you?
The location is excellent.
Yeah, sure it is.
So I'm giving him a day or two to get a professional cleaner in. And also I'm really lazy and I don't want to repack and you know, have to find a new place and move with all my bags and my kit.
Your reaction to this whole situation could not be more different from what my reaction would be. So,
yeah, I know.
I'm sorry to hear about your cat pee troubles, but it seems like you're not doing a whole lot to extricate yourself from this situation.
Now that
I
say
it out loud.
Because you don't
want to move your bags.
Now that I say it out loud, I see that it sounds silly, but from my perspective,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
leave it with me. Let's okay. do some follow-up from the last episode,
okay.
which I believe was about, well, it was about all sorts of things as usual. It was about advertising, clutter in the house, funnily enough.
Yes.
There was a bit of freebooting in there as well.
Yes.
Were there any things you were particularly keen to follow up? I've probably talked enough for now.
Yes. Well, the first thing that I wanted to follow up is talking about reviews that we have gotten. So the iTunes reviews that people have left. And so I was checking this afternoon and I made a little spreadsheet. And so at the beginning of episode five, I think we had four new countries that had left reviews last time. For this episode, we actually have a bunch.
What are the new countries, or is it too long a list? I want to see if you've been to any.
Okay, here we go. So I'm going to run down. I'm going to run down the list, and this is of as of this morning. So, in alphabetical order, they are Brazil, Chile, Colombia, Croatia, the Czech Republic, the Dominican Republic, France, Hong Kong, Hungary, Iceland, India, Latvia, Lithuania, Luxembourg, Malaysia, New Zealand, Portugal, Romania, Russia, Singapore, Slovakia, South Africa, South Korea, Spain, Taiwan, Thailand, Turkey, United Arab Emirates, Venezuela, and Vietnam. So I think that is an incredibly impressive showing, and I just want to thank all of the listeners who left iTunes reviews in those various countries.
Have all those people like done written reviews, or have they just like given like a 5-star or a 3-star, or have they actually written stuff?
Oh, so iTunes counts it if people leave a star review.
Okay.
So that just counts as star reviews. They are not all written reviews, but I have to say, almost all of them are written reviews. We have a great ratio of people who leave written reviews versus star reviews. So, I was quite impressed, and I just wanted to thank all of our listeners. And it's very cool just seeing that people write in from all of these various places.
That's
and they leave.
Me too. Let me say thank you as well. Thank you. That's amazing.
Yeah, they go through and leave very nice reviews. Just very impressive, this whole bunch. And I was particularly, of all those countries, sorry, I'm going to pick one out to talk about just a little bit. But I was very happy to see that we had Iceland there. Iceland was the least populous of the bunch of countries that left reviews. They have 321,000 people, and we got a review from there. I was very happy to see that because I actually went to Iceland for a trip with my wife a while back when we were newly married, and it was just one of my favorite trips that I ever took. The country was just beautiful, and we did a road trip that went around the whole exterior of the island, and it was just amazing. And if I'm ever fortunate enough to have the chance, I will totally love to go back to Iceland at some point. So,
did you go into the interior?
No, we didn't go into the interior. That I think might maybe again, if I get to go again, we might do a trip sort of across the island going into the interior. I don't know. Have you been to Iceland?
I have not. I really want to go. I've been reading a lot about it lately too, because I've been reading all these chess books, and obviously the Bobby Fischer, Boris Spassky sort of game of the century was held in Iceland, and Bobby Fischer ended up in Iceland as well. So he has a big association with the country, which has furthered my intrigue with it. I've not been. I really want to go.
It's beautiful. And I will say one other thing about Iceland. There seems to be per capita an unusual amount of artistic creativity that comes from Iceland. So like, there are a lot of bands that are from Iceland that are unusually good. And on Flickr, for example, it's a photography website. Some of the most amazing photographers you're ever going to come across, they're all from Iceland, partly because they have amazing things to photograph, but the technical quality of their photos are so great. And it comes up all the time. And I wonder if this is a byproduct of, since they're so far north, you have a lot of time during the winter to try and perfect your craft. You don't have a lot of distractions. So I wonder if people are indoors, working on and thinking about their own particular hobbies and creative pursuits, because it seems like an unusually creative country per capita. Anyway, so Iceland, I have a lot of positive feelings towards them.
This episode of Hello Internet was brought to you by the Iceland Tourism Commission.
Yes.
I have a grey-like correction to make.
I
wouldn't normally do this, but I thought it would just appeal to you.
I'm very intrigued.
In the previous episode, I referred to a Mr. Johnny Fingers from the Boomtown Rats, mm-hmm. who I had met a few times at a Japanese music festival, mm-hmm. and I referred to him, I believe, as an Englishman. Mm-hmm. He is, of course, and very obviously, Irish.
That's bad, Brady.
I know. That is bad. Especially someone, Irish heritage like myself. So I apologize for this mistake. I realized it very soon afterwards, thought maybe I'd get away with it. Someone did point it out on the Reddit. Mm-hmm, apologies.
Good. I'm glad you've corrected your error.
I know. I thought you'd like that. You love that kind of stuff.
I appreciate that you took the time to set the record straight.
Yeah. All right. You got another follow-up? I've got a couple here.
Well, what do you have?
Clutter.
Yeah.
In the house.
Yeah.
I thought that was an interesting discussion we had last time. This was obviously the fact that you sort of despise objects and trinkets and items in the house.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember thinking at the time to myself, as the conversation unfolded, everything that was said just made you sound like this uber cool man of the future and this sort of high tech amazing person, and made me sound like some weird hoarding person who probably walks around the streets with plastic bags full of junk. And I found it very refreshing in the comments on the subreddit, which is obviously very, you know, skewed towards you because it's your subreddit.
Mm-hmm.
I thought this was going to be the tone of the conversation.
Mm-hmm.
And I found it very refreshing how many people thought you were the crazy one.
What I would say to that is, yes, there was definitely a whole bunch of agreement with you that I sound a little bit crazy. But I still defend my position. Although I do want to say a couple of people, and I've been doing this on the Twitter as well, were directing me toward the minimalism section of Reddit. So there's a whole subsection for discussions about minimalism. And I would not say that I am, just to be clear, people, I'm not like a minimalist. I would think that I am more just a functionalist, that I don't like objects that aren't doing something in the house or serving some kind of purpose. If, you know, if it's just there, I don't know. I don't like them. I was complaining about it on Twitter earlier, and I was tweeting some pictures of some houses that were beautiful houses, but they're just filled with pointless stuff, like a decorative horn on a table or like plants all over the place, especially fake plants all over the place. Like that.
I saw that when you tweeted though, Gray. I saw that when you tweeted where you said, beautiful house, I can't believe how they've, like, you know, ruined it with all the clutter.
Yeah.
So I went and had a look at the pictures.
Uh-huh.
And there wasn't that much stuff in it.
Oh, no, no.
I thought it was pretty Spartan.
No, did you? Oh, okay. You know what? It's making me angry. Okay, so people, I'm going to put a link to this thing.
I'm not saying it was like all white walls. It did have stuff in it. Don't get me wrong. But it wasn't. I was expecting it to be one of those, you know, TV show documentary house from hell up to the ceiling with rubbish. And it just had a few nice objects. I'm seriously thinking of withdrawing the invite that I've extended to you to come to my new place.
Well,
I don't think you'll be able to handle it.
Again,
and haven't even got that much stuff.
Well, you forget I was in your old house, and also you forget when I'm looking at these things, I'm judging them by the standard of would I want to live there. And so I don't, when I go into somebody else's home, I'm not thinking, oh God, look at all this person's stuff. Because I'm not in that mindset of would I live in this person's house, but I'm visiting somebody else's house. It's totally different.
So you're saying you wouldn't have lived in my house?
I would. Well, not the way you had decorated it. No, I would not have lived in your house the way you would have decorated. I'm sorry to you and the missus. But no, if I lived there, I would decorate it totally differently. But no, I'll put a link to this place. So
our house is lovely.
Your house is lovely. I'm not going to argue that. But it's a different question of would I decorate your house the way that it is decorated? I would not. Okay, anyway, people, I'm going to put a link in the description to the show that you can go look at. And it's the interior of a house, which I think is beautiful because I like the textures. So I don't actually like empty white rooms. For various reasons, I don't like being in a place that is all white. So this house has like gorgeous mountain views and the walls are stone and the floor is wood and it's beautiful. But I'm just looking in these pictures and they just have like a dead tree branch that's acting as ornament in one location. There's this twisted horn on a table that serves absolutely no purpose. There's gross, just
it
fake
reflects
plants
it reflects
that do
the
nothing.
Outside and the heritage of the place. It's in a forest.
God, no. They have this horrible like crystal lamp that just ruins absolutely everything.
I'm not saying the place was to my taste. It wasn't. I just don't think – I just wouldn't have described it as cluttered.
I'm not saying it's cluttered. I'm just saying that they ruin it with all of their stuff. Oh, and in the bathroom here, this is the worst. There's like just a chunk of amethyst randomly on the counter and like a little, I don't know, a cactus or something horrible. And it's like, why don't you just have that beautiful countertop clean? Just don't don't put something totally pointless on there. It's infuriating to me.
But you don't mind like the stone walls though, and all the wood, even though that comes from nature and it's dirty.
I think
a cow pooed on that stone once and things like that.
I assume that it is cleaned. But no, the reason I picked this house out in particular is because I love the look of the dark stone walls and I love the look of the wood textures. I just think you don't need all these fake plants. You don't need a ram's horn on the table. You don't need all of this junk on your lighting fixtures. It's just hideous. Like the things that they put there. So anyway, that's enough about this. I've had a few interesting conversations over Twitter about this stuff the last couple of days.
We spoke quite a lot about advertising last time.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I feel like there's a lot more to say about advertising. Not today, but
yeah,
I can imagine that we will talk about advertising again because we concentrated on a very small aspect of it, and there's been lots of feedback and lots of things said. There was one thing I wanted to bring up,
mm-hmm.
and that was, again, a comment someone made. During the talk, I spoke about how when I listen to American sports commentary, I find it strange that suddenly they'll, you know, in the middle of talking about a play that just happened, they'll say, by the way, you know, you should go and buy a Toyota from New York Toyota dealers. They're wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that was jarring.
Mm-hmm.
And someone, by the way, that I would never criticize American sports commentary, by the way, because I think American sports commentary, funnily, and it's probably the best in the world. I think as I turn to a grumpy old man, I don't like a lot of sports commentary around the world, but I think the American commentary is of a very high standard. But I do find these ads in the middle of things strange.
Mm-hmm.
And someone pointed out to me, oh, so you find that strange, but you don't find it strange that in other countries they have advertising plastered all over the shirts. And I thought that was a really interesting observation. It was something I was aware of, but I hadn't thought about it at the time. And that is, although I associate the United States with kind of, you know, capitalist place and everyone's out to make a buck and advertising, sports shirts have remained a kind of a sacred cow, I guess. They won't put ads, you know, you won't see an ad for Toyota across the front of a New York Yankees top or something like that, whereas in most other countries, you know, English football shirts are covered in advertising. I found that a really interesting thing, that kind of the American sport has held out in that respect and won't sell that valuable real estate to advertisers generally.
Huh. This is a case where I don't watch enough sports. I didn't realize that was the case. And I guess maybe in my head I'm thinking of is it NASCAR? There's some outfits that have logos
NASCAR is not an example of that. But if you have a look at baseball teams or football and basketball, things like that, I'm sure people will point out all the areas where there are exceptions to this. And you do get small sponsors logos for Nike or whoever made the shirt. But generally you don't get big brand sponsors across the front of the professional teams.
Yeah.
Whereas, you know, in most other countries, that happens. So it was interesting. I don't know why it is. People will no doubt point out some mistakes, but they also might point out some theories as to the rules or the reasons that the shirt, the clothing, has remained this sacred cow in America.
I don't watch sports enough to know, but yeah, just Googling for a couple sports uniforms, I can see they're all relatively clean, but not NASCAR. NASCAR is not.
No, not NASCAR. At all.
So that doesn't follow the rule.
I think that's the most of my follow up.
We're good. There's nothing else that I think we need to mention in follow up for this week.
If this is the point where you're now going to insert our sponsor's message,
yes, that's
probably going to be really weird, isn't it? Because I've just talked about sacred cows and not having advertising.
That's true. And now there's
going to be the little noise, and Gray's going to read the ad.
That's true. I was about. Well, this is the point at which I would normally cut to ad, and now you're making me feel really awkward about it. So,
I'll let you edit your way around that, and we'll find out how you dealt with it later.
But maybe I won't, right? Maybe any second now the little doo-doo-doo is going to come up, and I'm going to switch into my more professional voice for doing announcements. But no, you're making me feel real awkward now. So let's see. There's got to be one more little thing that I can talk about.
No, just cue the noise. Play it now. Do it. Do it now. Cue the noise on the count of three. One, two, three. So there we go. We're back. We're back from the professional ad.
Yes, we are. That was an amazing product or service that I advertised, which current me does not know what it's going to be. But you, dear listener, know what it was. So there we go.
And can I just add my endorsement to that product, which I also don't know what it is.
Yes.
But if it has been chosen by you or me, I think it means we do support it because we wouldn't do a read for someone we didn't like.
That product or service is an excellent product or service.
As I was out the other night and I was offered a lift home by someone of somewhat more means than me.
Mm-hmm.
And he drove me home in his Tesla motor car.
Ooh.
This was quite an experience, and I was very impressed. I'm not a car guy, and I don't know if you are, but I'm pretty sure you don't own a car.
Well, I'll let you take a guess. Do you think I'm a car guy, or do you think I'm not a car guy?
You are not a car guy.
You win!
But this would have changed your mind. This was, if CGP Grey was going to love a car, this was the car. This car I described as like a MacBook Pro with wheels. It was like, because it was silver and cool, it was quite functional.
Mm-hmm.
It was functional. It had like, the guy said, have a look at this. And he opened up the front, the, what would you call that? The hood or whatever.
The hood, yeah.
And it was this huge expanse of space. There was obviously no motor there.
Mm-hmm.
Huge amount of storage. And then we went around the, like, TARDIS-like. You were thinking, how can there be this much room in the car? And then we went around the back and he opened the back. Again, no power system there, just a huge void for storage. I don't know how the thing moves because I never saw where the engine could be.
Mm-hmm.
Then we got in and it was like, it was lovely looking and everything was beautiful and it was all screens and high tech and he just said the address where we wanted to go and then the map popped up on a different screen next to the electronic speedometer and it was like, and there were all touch screens everywhere and he could surf the web while he was driving and
that's actually terrible, I think, but
well, I did say that to him, but he said he's had the video disabled, like that made it okay, but he could still like look at web pages. But like, It was really lovely. It was really high tech. Everything was functional. And you could go into all these touch screens and systems to do with controls of the car. It was silent like these electric cars are. And I asked, well, you know, does that mean it's a bit gutless? And he was like, watch this, and planted his foot. And it was like the space shuttle launching. It was so powerful and fast. It was lovely. It was a lovely thing. And I think you would have approved.
I it's interesting to hear you say that because, yeah, while I am not a car guy in the least, I have been kind of following the news with Tesla for a while because both I think that their company and their founder, Elon Musk or Musk, I'm not quite
Musk,
sure about that. Elon Musk. Yeah. So both the company and the founder are very interesting.
Yeah.
And I'm not a news person. I don't keep my fingers on the news all the time and I'm not really interested, but there are a few things that I do kind of search out every once in a while that I keep on my radar, and Tesla Motors is one of those companies. I think they are unusually interesting, and I suspected that I would like the car from what I have seen online of some demos of it or some people taking it for a ride. So it's interesting to hear that you like it.
This one I went in, as I said, the gentleman who was kind enough to give me a lift had enjoyed some business success over the years. So he was actually, this one I was in was one of the first 100 that was made. They've made more now, but this was one of that original batch.
One of the original ones, right?
Yeah. So he was saying he paid for it and put the money down and with the knowledge and being told from the start, if this fails, you're not going to get your car. And you're not going to get your money back.
Mm-hmm.
But he was sort of enthused enough about the project to say, "I'm all in."
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And he's got his flash car now.
Yeah, they're very cool. And at least at the time that we are recording this, but, you know, if you're listening to it in the future, you may know if this has or hasn't happened. But there are some rumors swirling about possible Apple acquiring Tesla Motors. Both Tim Cook and I know the CEO of Tesla have acknowledged to have talks with each other, that they've been chatting. They won't really say about what. And so there's just rumors about maybe Apple's going to acquire that company, which would be interesting. And the things that I've heard is that their overlapping interest is in battery technology, that that even though they seem like these companies might not have very much to do with each other, that they are actually their interests are aligned in improving battery technology. And maybe there are ways they can work together to solve this problem. But so, future listener, you may know if that ever happened. But at least it's an interesting rumor that's going around nowadays. And it does seem like the design of these companies might be somewhat compatible. And yeah. Anyway, I think that is interesting. I'm not putting any money on that, but it's an interesting prospect
The car felt like an Apple product in some ways. I don't know. I know that's a controversial thing, and people will get upset. But anyway.
And anyway, Apple just came out with their car OS this week as well. So.
Oh yeah, I saw that, but I haven't read about it. So the other thing I wanted to just talk to you about in this context of what's been going on with me was. We mentioned I was in Berkeley, and you even said yourself, oh, you're in San Francisco.
Yeah, I did.
What's this? Where do you stand on this situation where, and I know it, sometimes it depends on how far away you are from the place, but like people in, I consider myself to be in San Francisco, you know, I look out the window and it's the Golden Gate Bridge and the big pyramid building and the bay, but everyone here refers to Berkeley like, it's completely removed from San Francisco. Like they would never say San Francisco. What do you think about that? Like, and I know this is true in lots of different places too. Like people like to sort of consider themselves to have this different identity. But
well, this is the what's called the narcissism of small differences, right? Which is I first came across this. I remember in college, right, where I discovered. If you're talking to random people and you're likely to get into an argument, you get into arguments with two kinds of people, and they're the people who are on the opposite end of the spectrum from you. And so I was doing physics at college, like, and you'd get into some argument with like an art major if you're a physics major about something.
Yeah.
But then the other people that you have arguments with, more intense arguments, are the people who are close to you but ever so slightly different. And so like the most intense arguments ever would happen between the physicists and the chemists, right? Like you're both these, like this hard physical
or the
science.
Nuclear physicist and the quantum physicist.
Yeah, within the fields, right? And so I think that's the same kind of thing that from an outsider's perspective, like if you are an English major, in some sense, like the difference between different hard science specialists is like kind of irrelevant from your perspective. It doesn't really matter. Yeah. Like, oh, they're just science majors. It's like, oh, no, I'm not a science major, right? I'm a physics major. This is incredibly important to me. And so it's always just a matter of perspective. And like, so for me, as someone who doesn't live near the San Francisco area and has been to the San Francisco area four times in my life, maybe, you know, and twice was for those very brief YouTube conferences. If you made me sit down and think about it, I would probably recognize that Berkeley is not San Francisco. But since I'm not from there, like this distinction is not as important or as foremost in my mind. And that even goes for I know very consciously, like everything from Mountain View up to San Francisco in my brain is just San Francisco. Even though I know those are different places to the people who live there. So
the other thing I wanted to ask you about was just more to just sort of gauge American knowledge of these things, and that is universities. Because I also went to Princeton last week. It was like the middle of nowhere. I got on this train in New York and out into the middle of New Jersey for 2 hours and then changed onto this other little poodling train out to this little place, and there was Princeton. And I didn't really, you know, Princeton's one of these places, you know the name. and maybe you know it's in New Jersey. I think maybe probably a lot of people don't. Mm-hmm. You don't know where these places are. And I think Berkeley, like, you know, probably for a long time as well, a lot of people probably know the name Berkeley,
mm-hmm.
but might not know that it is, you know, sort of in San Francisco.
Mm-hmm.
And there are all these famous universities with these names that don't really give away where they are the mm-hmm. way that the University of Nottingham kind of gives away where it is.
Yeah.
You know, or Cambridge.
Yeah, or Oxford.
Yeah. So do most Americans who are obviously more familiar with their university system immediately know where all these places are? And as an outsider, am I still learning? Or do you think a lot of Americans also are a bit in the dark as to where these places actually are?
I'm not sure that I could speak for most Americans here. I mean, you hear about the Ivy League, you know, as the top tier universities. And even off the top of my head, I couldn't name all the universities in the Ivy League. And I know there is one funny one because the Ivy League – you think of Ivy League as having to do with like the top universities. But the Ivy League actually has something – is to do with something else. It's like sports team related.
That sounds like a CGP Grey video if ever I've heard one.
Yeah. So I guess I would say that – and here is my biases, right? Like, so I grew up in New York. And so, obviously, the East Coast of the United States is the best coast of the United States because that's where I'm from. And so, like a ton of these universities. So when you hear like, I mean, if you think of names of famous universities, so you have like there's Harvard, there's Cornell, there's Columbia, you've got Yale, you know, all of these places. In my whole brain, right, it's like, oh yeah, all of those awesome places, they're just on the East Coast somewhere. Because obviously the East Coast is awesome and it has all the best schools. And Berkeley is like I only know that Berkeley is like, quote, in San Francisco because that was the one that was just the oddball out from my experience. It's like, oh, yeah, and there's Berkeley, but it's all the way over there in California, right? Whereas I just know that all of these other awesome universities are vaguely around where I am and I don't know too specifically exactly where they are.
Is Berkeley Ivy League? It's not, though, is it anyway?
I don't think it is Ivy League because, again, like the Ivy League is a weird – I have to look it up.
But Berkeley's public as well, I think, so although it's got this huge prestige, I think it's a different classification as well.
Yeah, so I'm looking it up. So on the Wikipedia, the source of all human knowledge.
Yes.
The Ivy League is a collegiate athletic conference composed of sports teams from 8 private institutions of higher education in the northeastern United States.
Right.
And yeah, it's Brown, Columbia, Cornell, Dartmouth, Harvard, Princeton. The one that I was thinking of is sort of the odd one out in my mind always is University of Pennsylvania and Yale University. A good old Wikipedia, the very next sentence is, the term Ivy League also has connotations of academic excellence, selectivity in admissions, and social elitism. So there we go. That's what Wikipedia has to say about the Ivy League.
Fair enough.
But yeah, so anyway, I don't know about most Americans, but all I know is East Coast is awesome, and that's why the best schools are there.
I do find the knowledge of where I know we've discussed this before personally, but I find it really fascinating about people's knowledge or lack of knowledge about where things are. And it happens, you know, I'm the worst of all. It happened to me a few weeks ago when I was looking at a map of San Francisco and I saw San Quentin prison.
Mm-hmm.
And like, I've heard of San Quentin and knew that it was this famous prison, but I'd never thought about where it was. And before then I wouldn't have known it was in San Francisco. Mm-hmm, and I probably wouldn't have guessed it either. So it's amazing though, there are lots of places that you are really familiar with and seem really familiar to you. And then if someone ever says, do you know where that is? Or could you point to it on a map? I think a lot of people would get found out. Not that it matters being able to point to it on a map, but I think it's useful. It's probably something you should be able to do.
Yeah. But it's always, this is always the issue of, like I was saying before, that like the relative differences for the people who are in a place versus the people who are not a place in that place. And so, you know, speaking of East Coast, West Coast thing, my wife sort of grew up in both Hawaii and on the West Coast. And so from her perspective, all she knows about the East Coast And she'll say, like, oh, it's all those little states over there. Right? And I always find this incredibly infuriating, right, because I'm from the – and so, like, I know the geography of the East Coast very well. And, like, we – as, you know, as a family, like, we went to all of these different places. And it's the same – it's just like the Berkeley, San Francisco thing, right? Like, are you telling me Connecticut is anything at all like Massachusetts? Because, like, because you are wrong, right? Like, these these places are totally different, right? And don't even bring up Maine. Like, Maine might as well be a different country if you're talking about New York versus Maine. Like, what do you mean they're all just a bunch of little states over there and they're all kind of the same? It's like they're totally different places. But yeah. But like, again, I can appreciate that to somebody who, you know, spent a lot of time in, like, Oregon. Oregon is huge compared to Rhode Island. And so it just – it all depends on where you're from and what matters to you in that location. And you can't expect people elsewhere in the whole wide world to know these things. Actually, I'll tell you, this brings up one thing that I've always found an interesting exercise to do with students that I used to teach. And they really like this as a bunch of English kids, which was the – name the 50 American states game. And, you know, because I'm an American, the kids always knew I was American. And if I just had some time to kill in a lesson, I would sometimes do this. And the kids were always really interested in this. And the thing that I found most interesting was how often they would, instead of naming states, they would name prominent cities and think that they were states. And so this would happen all the time. And I'm asking people to name 50 states, and I would get answers like Chicago, Dallas, and like that. I think is very interesting, just to get a little perspective on, like, what do people know about America who didn't grow up in America? And again, it's not reasonable to expect a 16-year-old English boy to be able to name all of the 50 states, and it's more just an interesting exercise to see, like, what has he heard of that might plausibly be a state. Yeah. And that's why I always like doing that.
I mean, that's not just kids. I know loads of adults. In fact, I'm sure if I was put on the spot for long enough, I could even fall into that trap. But I know loads of adults that will go, oh, yeah, Chicago, is that a state? Like, yeah. I mean, that's super common for people of all ages. All right, then. You got any videos coming out anytime soon?
Well, yeah. I think I've settled on the topic for my next video. Yeah. But it will not be out anytime soon, and that's partly because of the move that I mentioned last time that I'm still involved with.
The house move.
But so I think I've settled on the topic, but don't expect it soon, people.
All right. I'll ask you what the topic is when we're off air, because you probably won't tell me either. Just so listeners don't feel like you're missing out on something. He won't tell me either. But yeah. I'll ask him.
You can ask me, but that's true. I will not tell you.
What are we going to talk about today? We have got a topic. It's something you suggested. I know you were on Twitter asking the listeners for suggestions. What have we settled on?
Yeah, I was asking people for suggestions, and it is partly because I'm still not confident that we're going to make it to 10. Because I'm very nervous about picking topics, but...
Great, we did. We spent 10 minutes talking about cat pay. I don't think we're going to struggle to come up with 10 topics.
Yeah, but I hope to God that's never our topic in the future. Like, that's really going to be, you know, scraping the bottom of the barrel. The thing that I thought maybe people would be interested in a little bit is how we deal with email. And it's partly that's been on my mind precisely because of the move. So I've been... in our new flat, and my gracious wife has been arranging all kinds of people to come to the flat, like setting up the gas or setting up the internet or, you know, delivering furniture or installing something or having it taken out. And so my days have been very, very interruptible and very broken up. And so I know on days like that, okay, don't even try to do something like work on a script for the next video, because I need to block out chunks of time to do something like that. And so the past 2 days in a row in particular, I've been just doing literally email all day long, both days. And so that's why it has been on my mind as potentially something to talk about. I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. Sounds good to me.
Okay.
I ain't been emails. It's one of the banes of my existence. So
why is it a bane of your existence?
What makes you? Because I get so much of it.
Yeah, is it the volume of it is what just makes you sad?
Yeah, I guess that's, and also I guess, you know, I really like creating things, and mm-hmm. replying and dealing with emails is not a particularly creative endeavor. Mm-hmm. So, it is more of a chore. Mm-hmm. You know, quite often I'll think, oh, I've got a whole bunch of things that require emails, and then I think, ah, maybe I'll just go and edit a quick number file video. I'll go and have a look at that periodic video I wanted to cut, and then I'll handle the email later. Because then I'm making something, and that's mm-hmm. what makes me happy.
Yeah. I was going to ask, do you have like a ballpark for how many emails you get a day? Any idea?
Do you know what? I don't. I guess people who follow both of us on Twitter, if there are any such people that have done so for a long time, will know that we have a bit of a running joke that I sometimes, partly because of volume, but also because it just annoys you because you're so organized. Mm-hmm. I sometimes will screen grab the little red badge showing how many unread emails I have and just message it to you or send it to you just because it infuriates you to see my lack of organization. But those numbers are, you know, obviously have been in the hundreds of thousands, but that is a number that incorporates, you know, some like emails from YouTube as well, automatic stuff. So that would be cheating. I don't get hundreds of thousands, but I would guess I easily get 50 to 60 emails a day that probably in a perfect world would require my attention. But they don't all get my attention.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is kind of the ballpark. I was trying to just look at a couple previous days, and that's the same for me. 50 to maybe 100 emails a day that, again, in a perfect world, would require some kind of response.
Yeah.
My archive, I was just looking it up now because I've been keeping all my emails in Gmail for a long time. I have 9 gigabytes worth of email in my Gmail archive. So it's some enormous amount of actual individual messages. Yeah. It is huge. And yes, your endless list of unread emails just infuriates me when you sometimes tweet it to me to show me that little badge, because I cannot possibly live like that. But I think email is different from all of the others, because at least on something like Twitter, one of the reasons I really like Twitter and I'm very active on Twitter is it doesn't feel like there is the same kind of social expectation that the person you're tweeting at is going to reply to you. Yes. You know, and so there are tons of people that I follow on Twitter who I tweet at them when they say something, and I have no expectation that they're going to reply back, you know, because they're more popular than I am, or, you know, or they're just, I know they're very busy people, which raises the question about why I would tweet in the first place. But I think that's a nice thing about Twitter, is that from both ends, you know, the person receiving the tweets is not under a kind of social obligation to reply to each individual one. And then you can also just message at people and you don't have the expectation that they're going to reply. So I think that's good. Whereas with email, I think the expectation is much higher that you're going to get a response. And that, I think, is why email is partially much more problematic. Because the sender has a greater expectation that you are going to reply.
Yeah, that is difficult.
And that's why I think it's left over from letters, right? Emails are still formatted like letters. And I think about this a lot of the times when I'm sending email messages, especially with people I communicate with regularly, is the point at which you start to drop the salutation and the goodbye at the end, right? Because at some point you realize, I know who I'm sending this to. They know who they are. They know who I am. It says my name in the top, right? I don't need to sign this like it's a letter. But if I'm emailing someone who I have never contacted before, I will always write it, you know, dear professor, whoever, and then sign it with my name on the bottom. Yeah. So email is in this funny world where it still kind of feels like a letter. And so that's why I think it is more troublesome, because there is this expectation of reply. And
okay, well, the expectation's there.
Yeah.
The expectation's there. Do you reply?
Oh, man. So Right. this is where I may come off as just a total jerk, but it's just the realities of being in this position is that I reply basically to probably less than 1% of the email messages that I actually get. I very much schedule my email in a particular way. And so this is how my system works, just to preface how this happens.
Yeah.
People may be familiar with the system. I'm basically using something called Inbox Zero. I'll find a link for the show notes, but there is a sort of internet famous talk done by a guy called Merlin Mann at Google a number of years ago, talking about a system for managing email. And it's basically, if you've ever read Getting Things Done, the book, which I highly recommend, Inbox Zero is getting things done applied to your email. And so here is the basic, you know, way that it works, is that messages come in, you have your email messages, and you have a limited number of things that you can do with those messages, right? You can reply to them immediately, you can delete them, mm-hmm. Or they can be a kind of pending message. You need something to happen at a later time, so you can file it under like a waiting for kind of system.
Yeah.
Or you can file it as something to be actioned later. So there's like four things that can happen. And this is the way my system works. And I try very, very hard to really only look at my email maybe once or twice a day. It's not always perfect. But when I open up my email inbox, basically I just do this. Okay, I'm going through the inbox and all I'm deciding is, okay, am I going to reply to this message right away? And that usually only happens if it's incredibly brief. So like you will sometimes get one sentence emails from me.
Yeah.
Or it's incredibly important, which luckily doesn't happen too often. If it doesn't get replied to immediately, the next question is, do I need to reply to this at some point? Maybe not right now. And if that's the case, on my computer, I flag it. So I have a little keyboard shortcut so I can hit Control F and it automatically archives the message, but also flags it. So it shows up in my folder of flagged messages.
Okay.
And so that is going to be replied to at some point in the future.
Wow, that folder would grow very fast for
yes.
me.
Yes. Well, we will get to this.
Okay.
Or I delete the message. That's basically what happens. And
do you feel a little pang of sadness when you delete someone's, you know, beautifully written missive without even replying to it? What's something you would delete? Give me an example of things you delete.
The answer to your question about do I feel sadness is that I used to. And so I don't know if you've had the same experience, but I have had this progression over my YouTube career as I have been fortunate enough for the videos to become more and more popular, that the number of things that I can possibly reply to has decreased over time. Mm-hmm. But in the beginning, I used to reply to everybody who emailed me. And even on my early videos, you can see I would reply to almost every single comment if I possibly could.
Yeah.
That is still there. But as time has gone on, that is less and less practical. And so there was a period in which I did feel sort of guilt about not being able to reply to all the email messages that I received. But at this point, it's like I have gotten so used to being able to quickly filter out my email inbox that I do not have any guilt, because I don't have any time to have any guilt, because I've just gotten so fast at the keyboard commands of like delete, 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 flag, 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 delete, delete, flag, flag, reply, type, 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 enter, delete, 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 flag, flag. Like that's what I do when I check the email, right? It's like as fast as I possibly can.
You're like a robot.
No, it's just that you acknowledge it too, right? That email can be this endless time sink. Right. And email is not your job, right?
No.
You're not getting paid to reply to emails, right? Like if I just spent all day replying to all the messages that come in, like I will not have a YouTube career and my wife and I will be out on the streets, right? So like I can't spend a lot of time. I want to get email done as fast as humanly possible, because this is not how I should be spending my day. And I think for people who like my videos, I think they would agree, right? If you like my videos, you want me to spend more time making those videos and less time getting into a back and forth discussion with, you know, some person who happens to have emailed me about a particular thing in a previous video. Like, I get 10 of those a day that could be messages that just end up back and forth forever and ever, you know, at a minimum. And so I just have to delete those kinds of things. And so I guess the thing that I'm thinking of is like you ask, you know, what do I delete? And this is going to sound terrible, but if people email me, like, you first have to find my email address. You don't have to be like Sherlock to figure out what my email address is, but, you know, I don't make it public anymore. And that certainly has cut down on the volume a lot, because when it used to be, they were like at the apex of when I was getting quite popular on YouTube, but still had my email listed on the homepage, like, email me with your thoughts. At some point I was getting just hundreds and hundreds of emails, and I thought, like, okay, I can't do this anymore. And I took it off, but people can still know what my email address is.
Yeah.
But so anyway, people message me, and I would say that any particular email message that comes into my inbox, it has 3 seconds to convince me to not hit the delete button. and that is at an absolute max. And wow. I've gotten very, very good at kind of getting the gist of an email almost immediately and just being like, app, delete, goodbye, message.
Before I ask you about best practice, tell me some of the worst practice. What's going to get me deleted quick start? Okay.
Right. Yeah. So this is also, it's really interesting to be in this position because I like to contact experts if I can for my own research projects. I'm in this interesting position of I am also a person who is trying to get the attention of other busy people.
Yeah.
Who probably do the same kinds of things, who get lots of messages and just delete a whole bunch of them.
Yeah.
And so it's very interesting to be on both sides of that. And I have to say, I have very high response rates for the emails I send other busy people who don't know who I am. And I think that that's precisely because I've gotten so many messages to me where you can just see, okay, don't do this. So the things that I'm going to say, you can take it as a lesson in like how to contact a busy person and get a reply.
Yeah.
And so I would say instant death is a message that goes beyond the screen of my computer. Like as I'm deleting messages, if something comes up and the scroll bar pops up on the side so I can see you have written so many paragraphs, it goes off my screen. That is almost a guaranteed instant delete.
Like, even if they have like a killer first sentence that says, you know.
Right. So when I say I have 3 seconds, right, what that means is I'm very aware that I tend to read the first sentence of the first paragraph and the first sentence of the second paragraph at most to see if it's going to like stay my hand on the delete button.
Yeah.
And I have learned that if those messages are really long, those first 2 sentences that I read never convince me otherwise. And
okay.
It's like, you know, like you said, you're afraid that someone has sent you a Nobel Prize winning email and you know, you haven't gone through it. Like that can totally be true. And I will fully acknowledge that maybe someone has sent me an important long message that I would have liked to have read that I haven't. But because of the time constraints of the real world, you can't make decisions like that. You can't read every email as though it's going to be possibly incredibly important. You have to use these kind of mental heuristics. And one of the things that I have learned is that basically the length of the email is almost always inversely related to its potential importance. So emails that I'm going likely to respond to are relatively short. And that's one of the reasons why if I'm emailing a professor that I want to have him look over my script or, you know, a researcher or someone, my emails are as brief as they can possibly be. They're basically, you know, 3 paragraphs. Each paragraph is about 2 sentences long. And each paragraph is designed to hit a very particular point. So my messages to other people basically start with, here's why you might want to read this. You know, here's a link to the thing that I would like you to take a look at. And then I finish with the paragraph of, here's who I am. And that's the kind of message that I send out to somebody else, because I'm aware that that is relatively effective when people are trying to get my attention. Get straight to the point and tell me later who you are. You know, don't start an email with like the two paragraph CV. Like, I want to know, why are you contacting me? And then later I want to know who you are.
That's good advice. And I maybe don't follow that enough. I have a reasonable response rate too, but maybe it would be better. That's good advice.
Because it's I would just say it's something that I'm really aware of when I'm reading emails. And that's why I do the first sentence of the first paragraph and the first sentence of the second paragraph. Because almost always that first paragraph is some kind of introduction to who the person is. And it's like, I understand, like, you have maybe accomplished many great things in your life, but I can't evaluate that in context until I know what you're asking me, right? What do you want? And then if it's an interesting question, or, you know, it's an interesting proposal, then I want to know more about who you are. I don't just want to know who you are in the abstract. You know, again, this is for designing emails that are going to get a response from a busy person, not emailing your friends, obviously.
So that's like best practice, and that's actually I found that really interesting myself.
Actually, the funny thing is, for me anyway, the subject field doesn't really matter, because when I'm blasting through emails, I don't see the subject field. The way it's set up is, when I hit delete, like, the next message just loads. And so again, I'm kind of doing first sentence, second sentence scanning. So subject doesn't actually matter a whole lot to me, but that's just the way I have my own email set up.
Attachments, good idea, bad idea?
I don't think I've ever opened an attachment that anybody has ever sent me. it's just not gonna happen, people. Like, unless I know who you are, I'm not opening up some attachment that you have sent me. Is
that... What about that? What about someone you know, someone like me, whose, you know, name you know? Mm-hmm. How often do I end up in that deleted bin? Do I get an extra sentence grace? Or?
Well, you end up, I guess basically you end up in the, I'm saying delete it, but actually I archive it. I do keep all the messages.
That Nobel Prize email is still sitting somewhere.
Yeah. I mean, archive is almost functionally equivalent to delete in 99% of cases. But basically, if you've sent me an email and I don't reply to that email, I have archived that email. So that does happen. And it's because sometimes you send me an email and it just doesn't warrant a reply. You're just telling me something, which also gets into the weird email etiquette, which is just sometimes uncomfortable with people. You think, oh, you've told me this thing. Do I need to just say thanks?
If it's just like, have a look at this link or this video, I thought you might like it.
Yeah, that can be a little weird sometimes. And again, it sounds crazy to hesitate over sending a thanks link. But if you know the other person is also receiving lots of email every day, all of those thanks start to add up over time, right? Like, that can become quite monstrous.
I like some acknowledgement that things have been received, though.
Okay.
Because I can ignore a thanks, but not knowing. The worst thing for me, though, with that is when someone says, let's film together, mm-hmm. and I'll email back and say, brilliant, Wednesday, 3 o'clock is good, mm-hmm. and they don't reply. Mm-hmm. And until they reply that extra time, like, and say, yep, it's going, like, I won't put it in my diary, and then I just don't turn up somewhere. And they're like, I got your email saying Wednesday, 3 o'clock. I was waiting here. But until I get that confirmation, and I know that's more extreme than thanks for their email. But
I'm going to say, I find that totally baffling. Who are you working with who doesn't reply to confirm a calendar date?
Academics.
Oh, academics with their heads in the clouds, right? Because I would act the same way as you. Until I get a reply for something like that, it does not count. Mm. I'm not putting you in my calendar until I get a reply for that. Forget it. I guess.
Do you sometimes like? You've got all these, you know, procedures in place, and that's good. That's good. But do you sometimes just reply on a whim to something you normally wouldn't reply to?
Yeah, every once in a while, someone sends me an email, and I will just reply. But that is so random and such a tiny percent of my outgoing email that it basically doesn't matter at all. But it does happen on occasion that something will just randomly catch my attention.
Where does just out and out, and I say this like, you know, like we're Brad Pitt or something, and obviously we're not, but when you do get fan mail, someone just saying, thanks for the videos you're making, they're really good and they mean a lot to me. Do you reply to those ones?
Okay. Again, this is going to sound really awful, but no, I don't reply to them. And this is where it comes into the question of, like, is sending just the word thanks worse than not replying? Because a thanks just feels like it's totally empty and devoid of any meaning, right? Like, thanks, I have made no comment at all about the things that you have said to me. And so, like, sending a thanks is so, yeah, it's just so devoid of meaning that it feels more honest to not reply. And frankly, this goes, again, I'm going to sound like a terrible person, but I don't know. I don't know if people are interested, but interested in just how things are from a certain perspective. Like, this is what, going back to a few conversations ago, we were talking about Derek's comment, Derek of Veritasium, pretty Derek, his comment that, like, the value of positive feedback goes to zero, right, as you get more and more of it. And it's interesting because it's like, very many, I hate the word fan. I really hate the word fan. But
yeah, I know what you mean. Yeah.
It's an awful word because it ascribes qualities to the person that I don't think are fair. But let's say appreciative emails that you get,
yeah,
are almost all the same. And it's like this quote that all happy families are identical, but miserable families are all miserable in their own unique way. and it's the same thing with feedback, right? Positive emails are almost always all the same, but people who hate you have their own really particular reasons for hating you. And so the negative mail is much more varied in its content than the positive mail. Again, I don't really reply to either, but it's interesting when you start talking about getting lots and lots of email messages from people to see that. And it's very rare that there is something unique in a positive message that catches my attention. And I will mention one that stuck with me. Like, there aren't very many, but somebody sent me a message where they said that they hadn't really been speaking to their brother in a while. But at a Thanksgiving dinner, they discovered that they had both watched and liked my videos separately and that they had a whole conversation about my videos. And it was really nice,
yeah,
to be able to have a starting point for, you know, a new conversation with a family member. And I thought, oh, that, you know, that's really nice. And that's very specific. And I appreciated hearing that. And I think I replied to that person. But yeah,
it's interesting, though. It's interesting to hear. And I might take this further in a minute, depending on my mood. But it's interesting you're talking about in replying and this feedback about what what you get from it.
Mm-hmm.
But should both of us be thinking about what the recipient will get from us taking 5 seconds to reply?
Well,
what it means to them. And I know all these 5, 10, 30 seconds add up. But
yeah, well
it did pop into my head, that thought. I'll tell you why in a minute.
I have been on the other side of this. And so I have definitely sent fan emails, I guess, in the internet age to people who I thought were just totally awesome. And I would say that the thanks email, I honestly found a worse experience to receive than the nothing email.
Fair enough. Fair enough then.
I mean, that is just my personal experience.
Yeah. I see what you mean.
Again, I don't want to mention it in particular, but I have messaged famous people and gotten back the one word thanks.
You've got to tell us one, even if it's not someone who sent a thanks. People are going to want to know who CGP Grey sent a fan mail to.
No, I'm not going to.
You won't even tell me one.
No, that's none of your business.
didn't say it was my business, but you can still tell us.
No, it's not going to happen.
How you administer your email is not my business either, but you've spent the last 40 minutes telling me about that.
Yeah, but I'm choosing to mention that. I am not going to mention CGP Grey outbound fan email.
Sorry, everyone, I asked. Let me tell you why I brought it up, though. This is a slight tangent.
Yeah.
But it's something that was in my head.
Mm.
I was reading through one of the Reddit feedbacks about advertising.
Mm-hmm.
And this person wrote a comment about all the things they hate about advertising. Mm-hmm. I hate this. I don't like this. This bugs me. And it wasn't that long a comment, but they used the word I think 10 times
mm-hmm.
in the comment. And never once did they mention the person who made the free video they were watching
mm-hmm.
and what benefits they may or may not get from advertising.
Mm-hmm.
And I do think it's all very selfish. And I guess that's the nature of, you know, humans. But I do think it's easy to, and I promise you, I ignore more emails than you. So I am not, I'm not being high and mighty. But I do sometimes feel bad about people who've taken a long time to write something from the heart. And if I think they've written something from the heart, I know that sounds really stupid and mushy, but if mm-hmm. I think they've written something from the heart, I will write something and I will make sure it's more, I will say thanks. And then I'll make sure there is one sentence or one phrase in there
mm-hmm.
that proves that I read the email. Even if it, you know,
yeah.
even if it's their name or something like that. Because I think, you know, these people have taken some trouble. And I know loads. I'm not being, you know.
I just wanted to interject here because I think it was this morning. I don't know. My sense of time is all messed up. But I think it was just this morning I actually left a comment on someone's YouTube channel who had just made a YouTube video just basically saying that they enjoyed the podcast and they enjoyed the videos that I made. And I have the same experience that you do, which is that if I'm going to leave a thank you comment, I want the person to know that I actually watched the thing.
Yes.
And so I was going to just write thanks, but then I added another little comment just to prove,
yeah,
you know, I didn't just see that you made a video about this podcast. I saw that you made the video and I actually watched it, and you can know that through the comment that I've left. So that I agree. And that's also why I feel very strongly about this. Like, just sending the thanks is kind of worse
yeah.
than not replying, because the not reply is much more honest, especially as you said, like when I'm being a robot and I'm just delete, 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 you know, or archive all these messages. You know, if I scan it very quickly and see that it is an email that is positive, like I appreciate receiving that, but I'm not going to reply thanks 50 times a day to a message that, like, you don't get anything from the thanks. And
yeah.
you know, it's just, but again, these expectations with email that these are like letters makes email much more complicated. And even though I don't have any guilt about archiving those messages because it's just a practical necessity, that feeling of hesitation is still much more there than something like Twitter, you know, or Reddit messages, you know, which I just feel no obligation to not, you know, to reply to it in the slightest.
What about the concern, though? Because not everyone is as savvy as you with their writing. And, you know, they might bury the lead, as you say, in newspapers and put the important stuff down the bottom.
Mm.
And what if that means a missed opportunity for you? What if someone says, "Dear Gray, this is who I am, this is my life story, and I think you're wonderful." And then their last sentence is, "And by the way, I just found a huge diamond in my backyard and I want you to have it."
Mm-hmm.
And you've never even got to that because mm-hmm. you've deleted it. Like, does that... Because that would worry me. That worries me that some, or
I don't worry about this at all. No. Not in the yeah. slightest. And
yeah.
and again, it's because you can't evaluate things individually. The only question is, what is the correct system for maximizing the value that you get from email?
You're such a robot.
No, but like, what is your argument? That you want to spend all day using email inefficiently? Like, your argument is just crazy, right? My argument is correct, that if I have seen over time a particular pattern that certain emails that match certain heuristics in my mind just have nothing to reply to or have no value. I mean, sure, I guess I could read every single message that comes in every day. But like, that argument is equally valid for all of the spam I get, right? And when I look in my spam folder, because my email was much more public on the web years ago, I get thousands of spam messages a day. I mean, my spam folder is just enormous. Yeah. Right? Your argument is equally valid. What if the guy with the diamond sent you a message and it got caught in the spam? So, like, your argument is just crazy.
I mean, you're treating it. I know there's a balance here, but you're treating it like the Large Hadron Collider, you know, and you've got 300 million collisions a second to process, right. And you've got to start applying blanket rules, and and maybe they do miss a Higgs boson every now and again because of all these filters they apply at the LHC. Mm-hmm. But these aren't particle collisions. These are human beings, and
I would say that human beings are like particle collisions. And the thing that I will give you for this is that I think you know, some listeners may know, in college I did a dual major. I did physics and I did sociology. I was originally going to do physics and psychology was my original plan. But after a few psychology courses, I kind of came to the conclusion that these people were not sufficiently rigorous from my perspective, and that human beings – it's much more like an ideal gas, right? Trying to imagine the individual motivations of an individual human mind is just – you're never going to get anywhere with that. But if we look at humans in a collective manner like sociology does, you can draw meaningful conclusions from the behavior of hundreds of people in a way that like – pontificating all day long about like what a particular person's dreams mean, right? Or like, why did they do this thing? That's just a total waste of your time and your life. But like, what do 100 people do in this situation? Great, now we can draw bell curves about expected outcomes. And so I think the same thing applies to the email. Yes, I understand that there are human beings on the other end of that email, but it doesn't change that from my perspective, this has to be like a heuristic Bayesian kind of calculation, right? I have discovered from experience, right? Very long emails almost always have nothing of any value in them. So if you see a long email, you can just assume you can delete it almost immediately. Like just do a quick check and then like, nope, sorry, but, you know, gone. And, you know, again, there's certain kinds of ways that people open emails. Like just the first sentence I can know, okay, this email falls into a particular category. And if I'm wrong sometimes, that's going to happen. But I think that the number of times that I am wrong does not outweigh the time that I save by not going over each individual email with a fine tooth comb.
There's two quick things. Have you read the Foundation series by Isaac Asimov?
I have read the first two. I have not read the full series.
I love them. They're my favorite books. But they're interesting because they apply this whole treating huge masses of
course.
Humans.
Of course. Psychohistory, right?
Yeah, yeah. So that did make me think. But the other thing that's popping into my head is, exactly like you, I receive a lot of emails from people wanting to work together in some business way.
I have some thought about this, and so don't let me forget.
Yeah, okay. And it'll be, you know, will you join our network or can we advertise our new semi-automatic weapon on your channel or something.
Yeah, yeah.
And I don't reply to those. But the reason I'm sitting in Berkeley talking to you today is because I did open one of those and it was someone wanting to collaborate with Numberphile, who is now a really important collaborator with Numberphile, the Mathematical Sciences Research Institute here at Berkeley. And I'm here working with their mathematicians and making all these cool videos. And that wouldn't have even happened if I had seen the email and thought, oh, here we go again. Mm-hmm. And what I really want to do now, and I will do, and maybe we can follow up next time, is I want to go and find the email that was first sent to me by the director here that started the conversation. I mean, he's a really smart, excellent man, and I wonder if he followed the CGP Grey rules of attention getting. I wonder if he was smart or I got lucky or I read too many emails and it paid off. But I will find out. I will dig out that email and find out whether it was my stupid old-fashioned panning for gold or it was your theory that it was well-written and cut to the chase.
Yes, yes. I was going to say two things about this. The first, as a slight tangent, is that I actually got the most – valuable thing in my life from email, which is my wife. And I met my wife through email from an earlier internet project that I was running that she liked, and she sent me an email, you know, just as a random person on the internet. And that eventually led to us meeting and getting married. And her first email was very good, right? It was an email that indicated that she actually knew who I was, and you know, we had common interests. Right. So
have you kept that email?
Oh yeah, I have. I still have that. That is a valued.
I knew you were sentimental somewhere.
That is a valued possession. Of course,
it's an e-possession. I get that. Though. I know it's electronic.
You misunderstand me. I am not sentimental. No, I definitely have that, and it is great. And every once in a while, I go back and look at that. It's just interesting to know that my whole life has changed because of that particular
That's
email.
That's brilliant.
So,
do you know what you should do?
What?
You should have it printed and make a big frame out of deer horns and put it up on the wall.
Yeah, that sounds like my style. Yeah. The deer horns is a nice touch. I like that. Yeah. And the second thing, so now to get back to unsentimentality, get back to business, right?
Yeah.
And to your comment is that I have the same kind of heuristic, which is trying to identify very quickly, is this some kind of business email? And again, this is like the podcast of first world YouTuber problems, right? Oh, people send me business deals. And I definitely, if it looks like it is some kind of business deal, like you said, someone who wants to collaborate, I do read those much more carefully, still very quickly, but more carefully than normal. Because this is the case where, like your situation, I'm aware that something valuable may come out of this. Now, to be fair, I mean, you know, and I think the other YouTubers who we're sort of friends with, they know, of all of us, I am definitely the most cautious person, and I am the person who says no to the largest number of things. But I still do read through those just in case something comes along that I do think is valuable. But
just to point out, you'll say no to most business deals, but you are the one who married someone who emailed you, so don't get too high and mighty.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Yeah. even the business deals, I mean, people would not believe how many terrible, terrible self-destructive offers you can get as a professional YouTuber. I mean, just some of the worst things where people, and I think this relates to, you know, maybe a future topic, but people have written me emails where they want to pay me, I'm going to say substantially like sizable numbers of money to make a video that is just a terrible advertisement for their product, basically. And I think one of the worst I ever got was from a company who wanted me to flog their new internet sales process. They wanted to be like a new kind of PayPal. And they're like, oh, here's what you're going to do. We're going to give you a bunch of money, and you're going to make a video about the history of commerce on the internet. And it'll end with our product as the future of commerce on the internet. And it's just the, like, I'm never going to do that. And this is like what I think might be an interesting topic for the future is like the value of the people who give you attention. Like, I'm very fortunate to be in a situation where people want to watch the videos that I make. But I am keenly aware that one of the reasons so many people watch my videos is because they know when I release something, it's something worth watching.
Yes.
And that's why when I get just awful, awful business deals to flog other people's stuff on the channel, it just isn't worth it, because like I'd be betraying the people who have subscribed to my channel by, oh, here's a video, but it's sort of actually an advertisement. This gets back to like why it was kind of upsetting for me when people thought the Reddit video was an ad. Like, I was really surprised and caught off guard by that. But that's another topic for a different time. But business emails I read more carefully, but still, almost all of them are just terrible, terrible things I say no to.
I wrote down a few things I was going to ask you, but I think you've covered most of them. Was there anything else you wanted to point out on all of this topic?
I think maybe just the final thing that I would just say. Oh, actually, yeah. No, I was going to say the one thing I didn't quite explain, which is the whole reason I started talking about this, is my.
This always happens with you. We talk about some topic, and at the very end, you go, "Oh, one last thing." This is the whole reason I wanted to talk about it.
Yeah, that's exactly. Yeah, I'm sorry for doing this. I don't know how long you've been recording now. It seems like a long time. I'm sorry, people. I'll try to edit this down so it's shorter.
You're definitely going to have to edit it a bit because we've said a few things that make us sound like real douchebags.
Yeah, we might. I might.
Yeah, you'll end up sounding brilliant and I'll sound like a douchebag.
It's all in the power of the editing, Brady. You've got that's the power, man. I wanted to edit these things.
You've got the power.
I was on your channel that one time. I know how much you can edit stuff.
I'm paying the penalty for that one video. Yeah, go on.
No, I guess all I was going to say is email system that worked very well for me. Funnily enough, when I was a teacher, I actually kind of got, in its own ways, I got more email than I do now. But that is because at one school, and this is, I've talked to people who work in corporate settings. In corporate settings, you have the like death by carbon copy.
Oh,
where
yeah.
everybody sends an email to everybody else in the whole business. And at this one school, I remember once I was out sick for a few days and I came back and I opened up my email. And I'll never forget, the unread message thing was over 1,000. You know, I'd been out for like 3 days. Like, oh, my God. And just going through all of that, it was just CC'd on all kinds of stuff. So you can get a lot of email. You don't have to be like, you know, a YouTube person to get a ton of email.
No.
And I found that when I was a teacher, that email was more stressful because it was trying to find the needle in the haystack of like, which of these things are relevant to me? What do I need to know about?
At least now all your emails, love or hate them, are about you.
Yeah, it's relevant, which makes it easier to some extent. But what I was going to say is that the system that I used and that I still use and what I really recommend for people with that flagging system of I'm replying to an email now, or I'm not replying to it, or I'm going to reply to it later. The thing that really works for me about that is that later bit. And so when I was having a more regular job, I had a real schedule of every Wednesday I would clear out my flagged folder. So the rule was all of the messages that had a flag on it, they had to be cleared out of that folder. I had to reply to them or take the information out of them or do something with them, but they couldn't stay there in that flagged folder, past that Wednesday.
You're so disciplined. You're like a Jedi. Like, if I did that, I'd be like, I'll push it to Monday.
But
when I get back from holiday.
But here's it, like, if I don't think of myself as a particularly disciplined person, I'm aware that in certain contexts, there's a huge amount of payoff to following a couple of rules. And so for people doing email in an office situation, like I really recommend this system of check your email sort of twice a day, once in the morning, once in the afternoon, and flag stuff that can wait until whenever your scheduled period for replying to emails are. You know, that worked really well for me when I was a teacher. And the thing is, that works well for me now. But the reason people will see me complain on Twitter about email is that my cycle now is I mentally flag stuff that I can deal with after I finish the next video. Right? But since my video cycle is somewhere between 4 to 6 weeks, it means like what has been driving me crazy the past couple of days is that I will end up with a flagged folder that has 300 emails in it. And those are all messages that need a real reply, right? That's stuff that has passed the initial response, the deleted, you know, I need to reply because this is about, you know, something with advertising with the podcast, or, you know, this is a reply from some professor I emailed, or, you know, this is something about a research project that I'm working on. And so that's why I tend to have these just huge batches of 2 days in a row, 3 days in a row sometimes of like nothing but email because I've like blocked it all off in one period of time. But I actually think that works really well. Like I like batching similar tasks together like that. And so I think it's better to do email in blocks. You know, and if you're doing it on a weekly basis, like, okay, Wednesday mornings is like nothing but email. And I think you're much more effective that way than if you just kind of have email open all the time in the background.
I don't like batching. I like just a little bit of this and then a little bit of that and reply to an email. And that reminds me of something else I wanted to look at on Wikipedia.
Yeah. Well, I was going to say, you reply to email suspiciously quickly. So I assume that you just have it open in the background.
I check my email once every 15, 20 minutes at least. At least. It's like
that is an crazy, addiction. Man.
It's terrible.
That is literally a dopamine addiction.
It is. It is. I've got to a point now where sometimes I take it out of my taskbar on the Mac, because even if it's closed, I will just instinctively go down and open it. Like, even if I don't want to open it, I'll just go down and click on it and open it. I'm like, oh, I've opened it. I didn't even want to open it, but I've just done it like as a reflex. So I've gotten to a point now where to try and wean myself off it, I'm taking the email out of the taskbar. It's terrible. It's a real problem for me.
That is really terrible. You gotta break that dopamine addiction, buddy.
It is. It completely is. It's a real problem. And you know, so, but those ones I'm checking all the time. You know, I'm looking for emails from my friends or my collaborators, and you know, and
something
replying to them.
Yeah, because you use Apple. Something I've been experimenting with, because part of my problem is that, you know, when you don't check email very often, you're concerned about missing emails from important people. And so I have been experimenting with Apple's feature to mark certain people as VIPs. So they have a higher level of notification across various devices. So you may have noticed you've gotten like faster replies from me lately. But
not really. It still takes you 2 or 3 days.
Yeah. Faster than weeks, you know. Okay. So we're down to days. But I've been playing with that, but I still don't like it, and I think I'm going to stop using the VIP system at all, because to me the real value in email, like I run my whole life through email. My wife knows if she needs something done, the best way to make sure I do it is to email it to me, because then email is the starting point that filters through to the whole rest of all my organization systems, which we might talk about someday.
But just to clarify, you're not a robot.
I am not a robot, no. I wish I was a robot, but sadly I am not a robot.
But you have like this data entry point to your informational organizational systems.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. And my wife knows that email is the correct protocol for making sure that it gets into the right system. I forget what I was talking about, but so I have found that the VIP thing kind of it moves email to be more like instant messenger, like a back and forth, and so I'm not happy at all with getting notifications from VIP. So I think the value in email is its asynchronicity, right? That you deal with it when you have time for it. Otherwise, you're just inviting interruptions from the whole rest of the world.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you. Maybe this will be our final thing, but I'll tell you my super pro trick here with email. Hmm. You know, because email can just be incredibly distracting. You know, you open it up and you see all this stuff from other people. And so in the mornings, I try to wall off my life from external distractions as much as possible. It's not always perfect, but I try very much. But of course, something will often happen where you think, ooh, I need to email this person about whatever. And so to do that, you would need to open up your email. But then if you open up your email, you see all the messages from other people. And I want to try to avoid that until I'm ready. Yeah. And so I use my iPad for just almost absolutely everything. And there's a couple of ways to do this, but I use a program called Drafts, which basically allows me to send an outgoing email message without ever having to open up the email program properly.
That is a powerful tool.
Yeah. So I can, if something's on my mind before I forget it, I can send it out into the world without having to actually let the whole rest of the world in. And I do a similar thing on my phone. My phone actually isn't even set up to get email on it, because I don't want the temptation of being able to check my email every single second of the day. So I have a kind of outgoing only email account set up on there, so I can send messages out, but everything that comes into that account is just forwarded to my real account. So I don't see people's replies or anything until you know, it's time for me to check email at some point in the afternoon. So anyway,
and you don't have that addiction I have to want to know if people have replied.
I
envy you that.
That's
the advantage of being a robot.
I totally disagree with you here, and I am not joking when I say that it is a dopamine addiction. Like you've really trained yourself in this particular way.
Yeah.
And I was aware for a while that Twitter had become that for me, that I was constantly checking Twitter doing the same kind of thing, like, oh, Twitter's closed and I'm working on something. And then, oh, hey, how did Twitter get open?
Yeah.
You know, like, I didn't remember clicking that button, but obviously I did.
Yeah.
But to me, that's a real warning sign of this kind of feedback loop that your brain is getting into.
You sound really serious. You sound like you're like a doctor, like diagnosing. No, and
but
you are. And you are right, by the way. But it's yeah. just, you sound worried about me, and I don't want to worry you.
I think this stuff is very serious. You know me. I'm very concerned about decision making and thought processes, and it's like this is like the heart of my interests.
Yeah.
And because I noticed that kind of behavior with myself with Twitter, I have intentionally tried to cut it back to do a whole bunch of little things to make Twitter less immediately accessible and to make more conscious decisions about when Twitter happens.
Yeah.
But it is hard. And I'm just aware that that is something you have to consciously fight, but it is totally fightable. And I think it is valuable to fight that kind of impulse.
I'm trying, Gray. I promise. I'm trying. And I'll keep trying.
Yeah. On your email, if you have it open, you know you can just at the very least set in preferences so that the email thing only checks every hour instead of checking every minute. Do you know you can do that?
Yeah, and I've turned off the little red badge now, so I don't know when new ones come in.
Good. Okay. At least that's a start. That's a start.
All right. But I actually have to go now because I want to check my email.
All right. I'll let you go read those messages. It's super important, buddy.
Bye.
All right. Take care.